Well, hello there. It's very nice to be back and continuing our little sort of brass kind of fanfare thing, really. More use of brass, really, but fanfare-like entries to this. So we got up to 7M3, which is Yoda Raises the Ship. And I'm going to look at bar 50. So let's have a quick look here. Here we go. Which is really at the culmination of this amazing bit where he's lifting the X-Wing. Let's just play it in a note performer for the time being, with the timpani, why not? So really, really interesting. It's got an interesting thing. I mean, I've chosen this because of the fanfare-like quality at the beginning, but of course, it goes from that extreme to a different role that the brass play, which is this sort of piano role, which is sort of not to be underestimated, and it's sometimes sort of thought of less. It has an amazing homogeneous sound to it. We'll see here when it's combined with the strings that it sort of, you know, fills in gaps. Let's just analyze it quickly, just that chord. So we got the root, and we've got the fifth, and then we've got the root again, third, and then a doubled fifth. So he's got two fifths, two roots, and just one of those thirds. That then is in terms of the next sort of thing up. Let's go into non-transposing. So it's an interesting thing. Yeah. So with the horns. So let's just try and work this out. It's going to be easier to put this in bass clef for the time being. This is why we write in horns transposing, is because otherwise it's a nightmare to read. Oh, that makes it much more easily acceptable. So the bottom note is actually the fifth of the chord. Then we got the E here, then we got a doubled third, and then a doubled note up there. So we got two horns on the B, we got two horns on the G sharp, which is sort of, you know, melding with those trombone one and twos. So we don't have that there, that's missing from that chord. So that E here is missing, is contained within the first harmonic of this note here. So that's okay. And actually, we do have the E doubled here. So actually, we've got B doubled with the horns. We've got E doubled with that horn. But then there are two horns on the G sharp and the B. So it's actually quite a thick sort of major third sounding there, which is interesting. But we've also got this sort of fiddly stuff here in the harp, this sort of harmonic fudge. So it's very polarized in the strings. We've got that which is an octave below there, and then we've got quite high up in the strings with a sort of second inversion type voicing, obviously not second inversion chord because of course it's root position chord, but that's interesting. And then just three trumpets just playing closed position triad in this register as well, just in the sort of middle C register, just to sort of top things off. So it's an interesting one. You might sort of think, well, why that? But if you take them all together as a group, then it makes a little bit more sense. So that's sort of quite a sort of fundamental type of voicing for trombones and tuba, that sort of phalanx. So you've got the main sort of triad at the top, and then you've got the root and the fifth in the bass, like that as well, which will sound sort of rather homogenous and nice, basically. So when we go back into the fanfare, let's just look at each thing separately and then put them all together. So here we go. Yeah, it really does build up quite nicely. We'll analyze the chords in a minute, but I think just in terms of voicing, it's interesting to see where it goes. So there's a little bit of a chord change there from an augmented chord to a minor chord to another augmented chord, and then the real change. And we got that interesting false relation, which occurs a lot in John Williams. It's a particularly sort of English trait as well, which dates all the way back to the Elizabethan era. And when I say that, I mean the first Elizabethan era in the 1500s. So it's a sort of really peculiar type of sort of sound, but it's very, very effective, and it can be sort of quite evocative. So let's move on to, before we get into the horns, because they're sometimes tenorish and a bit fiddly because they're all sort of the inner parts of things. So what's happening in here? Well, we've got close position trombones with his favourite sort of major seventh type chord in first inversion with that dissonance of semitone at the top. So the moving part is this one, whereas everything else is staying the same. And then it changes here. That could even be a mistake. It possibly could be an E. I'm not sure. I think I might have made a little bit of an error on that one. But either way, notice how it sort of suddenly cuts out. And then on the top bit, it's no bass. It's this sort of rather sudden raw sound, which we get. So we have to look at the horns for that. So they're carrying that middle note at this point in E. But they make a lovely homogeneous sound altogether. So sometimes it doesn't matter necessarily what actual notes you're doing, whether it's the root fifth or whatever. What matters is whether it makes harmonic sense within each instrument group. Can you tell what the chord is? Even if it's not necessarily playing the root note, you know, there's no E here, for example. He could have easily gone like that. Like that. So with the E. But here he's just got the G sharp. And notice how the trumpet at that point, or in fact actually the horn 5 and 6, they're sort of cutting out. So to give a bit more added weight a little bit later on. We've already got that here. And then here, it's just filling in all the other parts that are not there. So there's a real sort of blend of sound at that point. And it's a really good example of that blended melange of sound, really. And very effective how the bass cuts out and then it comes back in again on that root note chord. Just a really, really nice little bit of writing, I think. Let's have a quick look at Yoda Raises the Ship in this. So go to bar 50. So it's interesting here. So we've got sort of very static strings. We've got sort of chimes going on. We've got a little triangle, which is sort of, you know, giving a little bit of frill to the glockenspiel and the cymbal right at the end. But notice how all that bass is cut out when it's going to this chord here. Boom, boom, that G major chord. So an interesting example of that. So I'm wondering whether this particular thing it seems to have sort of deleted all my annotations, which is a little bit strange. Maybe I'm using the wrong thing, but anyway, the point is that it's sort of very homogeneous, each instrument group contains its own sort of common sense, really. We can just sort of see sort of triadic close position, even when it's high and low, also triadic with an extra chord, high trombones as they should be. It's funny how some people sort of assume that trombones are always a bass instrument, which is crazy. It's not necessarily a bass instrument. It can be a role that they play, but not always. And in fact, very frequently, they don't necessarily play that role, which can also be confusing for orchestrators who are sort of getting started. Don't be tempted to always use them as bass instruments. That's unnecessary, really. So, an interesting one here. I'm trying to work out where all my annotations have gone. I mean, they must be there somewhere because I've done a whole sort of thing about it, but it's quite funny how that seems to just slip through the net. It must have been a sort of an early one that I did, and I haven't got it. But it's no time to worry about now. Let's move on. So then we've got 8M2, City in the Clouds, and then bar 51 of that. So again, you can see that I'm concentrating a bit more on the orchestral stuff rather. Brilliant, yeah. Ba-da-da-da-da-da-ba-dum. And those would be slurred, I'd imagine, as well. Amazing. It must be quite awkward to play. There we go. You know, this sort of extraordinary sort of augmented chord. I think the reason why there's a gap there is because it's actually part of an edit as well, that particular bit, possibly. But it's all in planing. And it echoes the bit that we had before. And it does the same thing again. Like that as well. So all planed at that point. So just an example of planing, which he does tend to do. Let's just put it in context. The bit where they're sort of approaching Cloud City at that point. Just a quick one for that one. Then we'll go on to Lando's Palace, 8M3. Very, very short here, actually. I think it's just one bar. Bar 30. So one day I'm going to be using Dorico and get as quick in Dorico as I am here, but I'm wondering whether that's going to be possible. We'll see what happens. Yeah, a little sort of imperial hint. Not a leitmotif, but definitely a motif nonetheless. That's just extremely short at that point, and really it's more of a horn cue as well, but also juxtaposed minor chords, which are augmented fourth away. Again, something that he uses quite a lot. Notice the rhythm, though. Bam, ba-bam. You know, they often have that sort of dotted rhythm in them with a lot of these sort of fanfare-esque things. Then I think we're on 9M1, but I'm not absolutely certain, so this might not work, in which case I'm just going to go to the next one I've got listed, which is 9M4. But here we go. So this is Luke to the Rescue, I think, and bar 85. Yes. So this sort of thing here. Very, very clever, isn't it? You've got quite a confident, let's call it, trumpet line here, but it's quiet. Little rebel fanfare like that. So starts in first inversion, second inversion. So there's a bit of a myth about what position trumpets are in, while they root position first or second. It just depends. It is mostly dependent on register. almost always. But as long as there's a triad there, we've got it. But notice how that's juxtaposed between this, which is the main theme. And then we've also got this, which is all accompaniment. Amazing sort of rhythmic sort of idea as well. So we got D over E flat. And then in context. All with chord tones of whatever mode it is at that particular point. So again, a short one, but nonetheless sort of quite interesting. Then we've got Trouble in Prison, which will also be pretty short, which I think is just right at the beginning, actually. Let's have a look. Yeah, here we go. So another sort of Imperial-esque type sort of thing. Stormtroopers sort of... you know, middling about. And this time it's a fanfare, all sort of minor chords. Again, juxtaposed. Like that as well. And that's quite a common trope, that chord progression. We find it in Indiana Jones. Like that as well. So that's just C minor and then F sharp minor as well. That sort of augmented fourth or diminished fifth lower. So a nice interesting thing. And I think that actually occurs again. Here we go. There we go. So another little fanfare-esque moment at that point. So then we're on to 9M6 10M1. Here we go, carbon freeze. And this is bar 6, so we'll have a quick look at that. You know, when you sort of look back at your work and you think, wow, can't believe I did all this. This is crazy. So very short here. Yeah. So it's part of that battle of bum. Into the Imperial March. Just a nice little sort of aside at that point. We've got this sort of Sibelius violin concerto string-esque moment, that sort of oscillation. There's sort of a bit of bubbling there. Lovely. And I love how that's orchestrated because we've got this little celeste part that goes with the flutes at that point as well. So not related to the brass, but it is going to be doing an imitation of that. But this is how it gets there. Lovely, isn't it? Really, really nice. So it's sort of low flutes. So that's where they are middle, you know, just above middle C. And exactly the same thing. So actually in unison at that point, which is not always the case with Celestian flutes, but bearing in mind that that one is. So another sort of short one at that point, before it sort of kicks off. Then we've got 10M2. And so this one is bar 116. So let's go to that one. And I think it's the original. Yeah, here we go. It's a nice little stretch of music, actually, but it's very fanfare-esque. There's a huge amount that's going on, but just in the brass. So I'll play all of it now. Notice how those horns really, really sort of, they don't interrupt the flow. They really help the flow in terms of these offbeat, digga-da, digga-da. Really interesting rhythm. Digga-da, ba-ba-da. Ba-ba. Little flash. Splash of colour. And here, they're just an octave lower than whatever the trumpets are doing. That's a good default if you can't figure out what to do. It's often a good default to go to. Indeed, we have it all the way here as well. It's definitely a hint of Alex North in that, and Spartacus, which was one of his favourite composers and an idol of his as well. So it's unsurprising that that sort of comes in from the 1950s onwards with Williams's music, which is when his whole career started. So, interesting one. Then we've got little bits of other things all the way through to the end. So we've got 10M3. Not sure how much is in here, actually, but we'll have a quick look. Yeah. So that sort of Boba Fett type sort of imperial dum da da dum bum bum. Yeah, I'm not sure there's much else. Let's just have a listen to the brass at this bit. It's sort of classic. Yeah, absolutely wonderful. So 10M3. I remember when I first listened to that thinking, wow, that's just so impressive. But how's it done? What are the chords? So in this case, it's all of this sort of interesting sort of 3-5. So here. So it's interesting how the resolution is equally, if not even more gnarly, than the point, the high part of the phrase, which is surely this bit, bum. So its resolution is that. with all of these amazing sort of quartal chords. That 3-5 as well, sort of E flat diminished with a sus 4. Really interesting. So not quite fanfare-esque, but it's so noticeable, isn't it, that whole sort of thing. Funereal. Bum ba da dum. And then we got this sort of amazing sort of little bit which goes on. The rest of it is not fanfare-esque really, but we do get a little bit of this digga-digga-dum at the end of the Han and Leia theme. That brings that to a close. Then we've got 11M2. So losing a hand, one of the highlights of the whole film. Bar 27 I've got written here. Let's remember what's going on. Yeah, so this is a bit where he's sort of just falling down the shaft. amazing that it is filled with those sorts of augmented. Or augmented chords as well. Fantastic, but yeah, that sort of, that bum, ba ba bum, little sort of fanfare-esque thing going on, which I love. Here we go. All in fourths. Which is really reminiscent of that Aaron Copland. Very, very sort of similar, but affectionately so, is not copying at all. And then we got this amazing sort of triadic descent. Sort of very Holst. Especially that bit right at there as well. Really, really interesting. And definitely one for future study as well. But I just love that bum, ba ba bum. I don't know why, it's just something that really, it's just something that really sort of stuck with me. And yeah, the chords are sort of actually quite simple. They're just, you know, major chords over a little pedal note, a D pedal. And then you've just got trills, and then this sort of thing, which is sort of almost like it's trying to catch up with that. So it's sort of in augmentation. It's very unusual. And then this amazing sort of flight of the bumblebee chromaticism as we got in sort of four piccolos, which all dovetail each other. Absolutely ridiculous orchestration. Oh dear, love it. So then we're into To Hyperspace. And I think really that's just... whoops, got the wrong one. Let's have a look. I think this was from bar four. Yeah, just here. Yeah, so it's all the way through this. It's exactly the same as when Luke is rescued in Hoth. And then it flits back to a completely different cue and then goes back into the Imperial March. And then it goes back into this sort of idea as well, the original cue. So the default option with the fourth trumpet, should it ever occur, is usually to double the top note an octave lower. As long as there's enough room. There we go, which it can do. And then the horns just sort of do exactly the same thing as well. And then we've got a lovely planing. As it changes chord, and that goes all the way through. So these wonderful sort of little bits. Let's play the whole thing actually from this bit. Notice we've got the harp as that's going along. That's really important. And notice that there's not very much else going on. So here, the trumpets are highlighted with an octave higher, where we've got also root position flutes. Piccolo, don't forget, is octave higher, so that's at the top. Yeah, sort of interesting sparseness to the orchestration, really, because everything else is a unison in the strings. A little bit of timp. Also, this short long, typical of John Williams. There we go. And that's pretty much it for that cue, I think. Can't really think of anything else. Yeah, I mean, it goes back to it eventually. It's a very, very long cue, actually, that To Hyperspace one. And then the very final bit is the finale, which is bar 30. So where are we? That is bar 10. So it's much further on. Yeah, so more of an accompaniment idea here. So that fanfare is much more of an accompaniment fanfare, and it's during to accentuate the harmony layer theme. Playing it through because it's such a nice piece. And it seems strange to sort of suddenly have the end credit on a separate sheet of paper, but it is, as it was just sort of done that way. And then fanfare trumpets at the end. So yeah, it's all about the brass here, really, isn't it? So I'm going to just use the brass in this whole thing and just sort of dissect it. So we got four trumpets. Again, fourth trumpets. An octave blow first. Planing. Block homophony. Just using the brass. And then we'll pick it up. I think that's mostly it. Yeah, a little bit of sort of the Yoda fanfare here. That's quite fun in the horns. Brilliant sort of major sevenths. And I love that, how that it's sort of almost sort of rebel type sort of chord progression at the end. And then typically sort of brass being used as an accompaniment. Very silly how Sibelius or note performer doesn't hit the end of that note. Really unusual. So jazz. Bum, bum. And then endless Imperial March, which just goes on forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. And then right at the very end, here we go. Hopefully, I think there might be another one. Might be the end of it. Yeah. So all unison here, horns and trombones. Typical sustained horns, offbeat, syncopated. Thank you. more trumpet fanfares. Ramps up. And then the proper fanfare at the end. And interesting that actually I think without that fourth trumpet, it just doesn't have the same effect. Notice how the strings continue to play, by the way, at the first part of that. And it's really important. Look how it gives it body. And very subtly sort of comes out diminuendo at this bar. So then when the rebel theme at the end plays out, it's much more noticeable. And again, the fourth trumpet typically is playing the top note but an octave lower. If it doesn't, then trumpet one and two share the top notes. Here, because we've got a four note chord at that point, then it does do something different. But it's important to remember that he does use semitonal dissonance at the top of the trumpets. And then he reverts back to the fourth voice is voice one, but an octave lower. And then it just changes register up there. Here we go with the brass. Also, notice the dissonance here, that we don't find it in the horns, but we do find the C in trumpet two, trombone two, and also trumpet two as well. It's that little bit of sort of, ooh, something's not quite right. It's a sign of war. Notice trumpets are not playing at that point because they've bust a gut trying to get to that. And we've already got massive chords as well. So all fine. So that's the end of that sort of little fanfare dissection, really. So we'll move on to other things next time I see you. And of course, I'm going to be doing A New Hope, which is really exciting. So that will also occur. But if you've got any suggestions to what to do next, then please let me have them. Might do a little Harry Potter thing, and I might even do some Lord of the Rings stuff as well, which might be quite fun too, just to sort of have a look at and compare notes. So that's all for now, and I will see you very soon.